I'm going to go ahead and get us started. My name is Jennifer Steele, and I'm a faculty member in the School of Education, and I am delighted to be here, really on behalf of the General Education Committee, which is chaired by Cindy who we kind of came up, Cindy was really the impetus for this session because a challenge that comes up in the general education program is, and Teresa's on the committee too, I should say, and she's going to talk about that today. A challenge that comes up in the general education program, which is changing, of course, to the AP core, the challenge is that there are fixed learning outcomes that these courses must have. And the fixed learning outcomes are really prescribed in the course descriptions, and they're prescribed in the description of what the general education areas should be. And those areas are changing as we switch to the core, but still there are very fixed, there's a very fixed idea of what general education courses should accomplish and what students should get out of them. So then there's a compliance question. As faculty teaching in these programs or teaching in programs that are externally accredited. So Fred and I are in School of Education. We have our teacher education program externally accredited by NCATE, which is the accreditor for teacher ed. School of Communication has externally accredited programs and probably other, like, well, engineering. I don't know if you have external.
Well, we're not, we don't have an engineering degree, so.
Oh, right.
Biology.
Yeah. Biology has externally. Okay, so this is, it's a big issue. It's also a big issue when you teach introductory courses where everybody might teach it a different way. And the question is, how different is too different? And how much freedom do we have to modify our courses as we learn about our students' needs? And how much do we really need to adhere to an initial plan and to an initial set of learning outcomes that were prescribed for a course? So I can talk later. I'm not really here as a panelist, I'm here as a moderator. But this has affected me in my 3 years at American University, this question of how much freedom do I have to go outside of what we specified originally. But our distinguished panelists are going to talk in depth about their experiences. So who we have with us today is, I'll go in order in which they're sitting, and then they're going to present in a slightly different order. So Christina Crona on the end is an assistant professor in the Department of Mathematics and Statistics. She studies mathematical evolutionary biology with a focus on adaptation. She's going to be discussing how she incorporates the language of science into her Calculus 1, 2, and 3 courses so that students are not only learning the expected calculus material, but are really prepared with the vocabulary to succeed in diverse fields where they're going next, which include physics, economics, biology, mathematics, etc. Then we have Dr. Teresa Larkin, who's an associate professor of physics education in the Department of Physics. She's also the director and faculty liaison to the dual degree engineering program. Dr. Larkin's research is on the assessment of student learning in introductory physics courses and the role of technology as an assessment and learning tool. So this question of assessing learning in intro physics is partly what she's discussing today. She's focusing on how she developed a general education physics course called Physics 200, Light, Sound, and Action, and how she has had to, over the years, subsequently modify that course. Then we have Dr. Charles Cox, Chuck Cox, who is a senior professorial lecturer in the Department of Literature. He studies composition, rhetoric, the teaching of reading and information literacy, and the use of pop culture to teach academic skills. So this question of information literacy, very hot topic today.
Yes.
Professor Cox will discuss how he teaches college writing, which is a multi-section introductory course, especially how he adapts the program's expectations to meet the changing needs of students. And then we have Dr. Fred Jacobs from my department. Dr. Jacobs is a professor in the School of Education whose research focuses on the role, function, and impact of higher education, the milieu in which we work, as well as public policy and education. Dr. Jacobs will explain how he has taken education's general ed course called Schools and Society, how he has this taught it for many years, but has this year taken it online, and how in that process he has had to adapt the course to meet the expectations for student communication and dialogue in a virtual environment. So what we're going to do is each person is going to speak about their experiences for about 5 minutes, and then we're going to open it up to a larger discussion and really an interactive conversation about these issues. So I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Larkin to talk about her experience.
Okay, thanks, Jennifer. It's really super great to be here. I appreciate that. And she's going to give me a 1 minute
next signal.
All right, so if you have to physically hit me over the head, please, please do it, because I'm passionate about what I do and I could like talk to you for the rest of the day about this course. Just so you know, I've been here at AU since 1996. I came here, I was working on my dissertation in physics education. Started teaching gen ed. I came here to teach gen ed. I found a niche in my field by working with non-majors, because most people don't care so much about how they learn physics, and I happen to, so it worked out well. And after about a year of being here, students came to me and said we didn't like our choices in Area 5, which is going to be going away, but sort of retooled, renamed. And we need more options in physics. So I was just finishing my PhD. I just finished it in physics education. I was just thrilled to be able to create a course that allowed me to bring in what I know is good pedagogy and curriculum and research on how students learn physics and bring it right into the classroom. And so a course called Physics for a New Millennium was born with Physics 200. And that name held for 15 years, well into the new millennium. And we finally retooled, renamed that course a couple of years ago. And I just taught it the first time in spring 2016 under the title Light, Sound, Action. As far as the course, it is taught in a non-traditional format. It's a lecture kind of lab combination. It's 75 minutes one day, 150 minutes the next. That's probably going to change when I put in a proposal for how I'm going to modify it to fit the new gen ed. But one of the things that I found, and ironically yesterday as I was cleaning some files in my office, came across a folder that I had kept some of the old syllabi, which is kind of ironic, that I found it yesterday from the first time I taught the course to the syllabus I just prepared for my spring class. And one of the biggest changes that I see there, besides just the life's experiences as an instructor, your syllabi tends to get longer because you had an issue about something, right? And all those kinds of things go in. But where I'm stating learning objectives and things like that has changed dramatically so that I can better reflect what's being done in the course and how it relates to the general education program. And also speaks to assessment, because I've been kind of a big one on assessment. And, you know, so it's using a lot of those types of words. But the course is really non-traditional, and I'm so glad I'm sitting next to a writing professor, because one of the big things that I have students do in that class is write a conference paper. And it's not just a paper that gets turned in at the end of the semester, but it's a paper that they work on the entire semester, and I publish the kids so that they can put it on their resume. And I, you know, so they go through the whole process of submitting an abstract and doing a peer review and all of the stuff that we would do for a normal professional conference. And that hasn't changed. But what has changed is, you know, the clientele. And every semester, I pay real close attention to the majors that I have in the course. And for a long time, and it's starting, I'm seeing a lot more again now, is the audio tech and audio production students taking the course. So when I have a large number of students in that category, I'm going to expand on topics that I know are going to be relevant, such as sound and waves. We do quite a bit with electricity and things like that. I just rewrote one whole segment of hands-on activities for electric circuits this past spring. And now I've been talking with the person who is modifying and coming up with the curriculum for a BA in dance. And they're thinking of having this course be one of their foundation courses for a BA in dance. Well, that gives me, you know, a lot of opportunity to be innovative. And I think that's why we all stay in school, right? We like what we're doing. We like college and being able to innovate and all of those things. So throughout, you know, this will be the 17th year I've taught this course this spring. And throughout, I've never done the same thing twice, large part because of changes that are imposed from outside, such as learning outcomes and those sorts of things, because, you know, I really do what's on my syllabus, and it's not just there because I has to be there for a committee to say it's okay to be in the gen ed or whatever, because I believe it's the right way to do it, you know. And so those things have been challenges, but they've also been, and how am I doing? 1 minute, okay. They've also been very rewarding challenges. Certain things I don't change. I strongly believe that in a technical field like physics, having the ability to communicate that through written and oral means is incredibly important to them long term. So these kids don't write lab reports like they would in a first level course. This is a second level course. And instead, they, you know, I try to get them to choose topics when they write, because they're going to spend a whole semester having an affair with their topic, is usually how I present it to the students. And I want them to be sort of a little bit of an expert in it. So it's served as a jumping board for internships and jobs and things like that, talking point at interviews because of this paper. So it's one thing I haven't changed, but there's been a lot of things that have had to change as I've watched things change through Gen Ed and that sort of thing. So I'd be happy to entertain questions when we're all done with our presentations. I'll stop.
Thank you, Dr. Larkin. So we'll turn it over to Professor Cox, who's going to talk about college writing.
Hi. So I've been in the what is soon to no longer be the college writing program. We're rebranding soon as the Writing Studies program. I'm in my 16th year, and in some ways, we are both one of the most and one of the least constrained programs on campus, in many ways just because of the nature of the courses we teach. Our courses, because they're writing-based, are not so much built around a singular shared body of knowledge, so much as a set of skills and concepts, ways of thinking and doing, you know, moves and dispositions that kind of transcend any one specific content area. Most of our students are first year, yet they come from all across the campus. So because of those factors, we have a pretty clearly delineated set of constraints, because we want to encourage consistency so that every student coming through the writing sequence has roughly an equivalent experience, that we can be sure that they've been exposed to and practiced and hopefully mastered the same basic set of moves and dispositions. But on the other hand, because it's built around skills and moves and dispositions, there's a lot of leeway for as many different ways as there are to write, there are as many different ways to teach writing. And so in many ways, my colleagues and I in the Writing Studies program have been kind of invited to innovate because of the nature of the courses. So for me, it's not so much that I've chafed against curricular constraints, so much as I've had a different tension, and my colleagues would agree, that on the one hand, we have the curriculum, which doesn't change radically over time because of the slow wheels of administration, because it takes a while for scholarship to trickle down to the classroom. But on the other hand, the student needs are constantly changing. So for me, it's less about how do I fit my pedagogy into the program, so much as how do I fit the students into the program. And so what I want to say are a few things that in recent semesters I've begun to do to try to, I won't go into the details, I'm sure we all know, about how our students are changing and the different things they're bringing in now that they didn't before, some for the better, some less so. So what I've been trying to do to kind of meet the students more where they are, yet stay within the boundaries of the program's curriculum, is incorporating more meaningfully and fully the concepts of play and community. And I'll say just a brief bit about those, and again, if you want more details, we can talk about it later. By play, I mean certain really, really fundamental concepts of game studies and game theory, and I'm going to be really, really reductive here in the interest of time. Basically, what I pull upon is the idea that games are defined by rules. Some rules create constraints. They dictate what you must do and what you can't do. Some rules open up affordances, the options and choices, and it's the interplay between constraints and affordances that create a game's possibility space, which is the zone where you have the actual play. And in many ways, that's what I try to do in the classroom. It actually kind of sounds like curriculum, doesn't it? There are certain constraints, but then there are affordances. It's finding that balance. So what I do in class, I do this at all levels. I try to show the students, or in many cases, make the students discover where those constraints are, where the affordances are, whether it's the course as a whole, a day's lesson, an assignment. And so I want them to not necessarily see the boundaries so that they feel confined, but to see the boundaries so they see where they have room to play. And there's a lot of ways I do that I can explain if you want to hear about the specifics. But like I said, I try often to make them find the boundaries, which is where the idea of community comes in, which I know that community in the classroom is hardly a new concept. But what I've been trying to do is make it even more integral to the classroom by making sure no two class meetings are exactly the same. Some days it's the full class together, some days it's groups, some days it's both. Some days the groups are determined in advance by me, some days I do it randomly. Sometimes they're big groups, sometimes they're small groups. Sometimes it's one group for the whole class, sometimes they're constantly shifting. And so they're always working together in different combinations to puzzle through a reading, to solve a research question problem, to look at a writing assignment and figure out where its possibility space is. And what I found is, I've only been doing this for a couple of semesters now, so I can't really say there have been like radical changes in their work, but I have seen big changes in a lot of their attitudes and their engagement with the course. For one thing, it opens a lot of options. The student who doesn't like talking in a full class discussion will always have smaller groups to work in, or who feels less of a leader but more of a follower will have chances. So if Tuesday's class doesn't meet their learning needs, Friday's might, and so forth. It also means that they can't hide, because from day to day they don't know whether their voice will be one of 20 or one of 3. So they have to come in prepared. And because they're doing a lot of helping each other and getting helped by each other, I find that they're starting to grow more of a sense of investment in everybody's performance. Because if you know that you're not having done that reading, it's not just going to affect you, it's going to affect the people in a group you might be in, you're more inclined to be invested and take part. And so, like I said, I've only begun, no pun intended, playing with these ideas recently, and I'm still kind of working through it. But what I'm trying to do is bring students into the curriculum by showing them that they can be invested, that they can play, that it doesn't have to be a stringent following of rules or a standard practice, but that it can actually be more of a shared playfulness that we can use as a way to learn.
Dr. Kona is going to talk about calculus.
Okay. So I have had the pleasure to teach both calculus 1, 2, and 3 here. And I have actually had quite a few students in at least 2 of them, some students in all 3. Calculus obviously gives me very limited freedom in a sense, because if I don't cover the expected material in Calculus 1, students would be in trouble in Calculus 2 or in other courses where they need calculus. They have to go out there and know something about limits, derivatives, and so on. So it's not that there are any expectation imposed from above that I have to cover certain things. It's sort of common sense. If they're not prepared, they will have a problem. What I have added, which I think really makes a huge difference, in 2 words, I would say, critical thinking. Many people at the university are focused on critical thinking. That's very central. What do I mean by that? Well, in order to consider a claim, is it true, is it false, do I believe this, is it maybe, we need to understand the claim. And for that, we need the language of science. To take something very concrete, if I say to my new student, following claim, a continuous function is differentiable. Many of my Calculus 1 students will not know what I'm saying. They will not understand the claim, a continuous function is differentiable. And the problem has nothing to do with the word continuous or the word differentiable. Now, in a theorem, in a math book, you will many times have that wording. It would probably be easier if I said, all continuous functions are differentiable. But I want to teach the students to understand the book. So I want them to understand the language of science. And I felt that that was necessary for being able to teach calculus, but I also felt that that is very, very important for students to come out as educated citizens in some sense. So, well, what do we have to work with? Basic concepts such as definition, theorem, proof, example, counterexample. When I was more new in academics, I thought that the most difficult part would be theorems and proofs. Over the years, and this is not only from teaching, it's also from communicating with medical doctors, biologists, and so on, I have realized that the most difficult concept is probably example. I thought people would know example since kindergarten, but it can cause a lot of confusion if I say this is an example, because people somehow try to read it as a general statement. Now we can take something very easy. You first, if you have very new students and you try to tell them what a polynomial is, then the abstract definition can be a little bit hard to digest. And then you say, well, for example, a polynomial would be x squared plus 7x. Quite a few students will look confused, and then someone will eventually say, I don't understand, how you got a 3? Can you explain how okay, and I tried to say that the number 3 here is arbitrary. And then I discovered that a lot of students don't know the word arbitrarily, and so on. So there is clearly a challenge in the language of science, and I think this is really deep going. I believe I would say even on the level of science, even in, on the level in articles in Science, Nature, and those things. You'll see quite a few articles for a tiny bit of critical thinking, where we actually sit down and think that the paper would have been rejected or not published in the first place. And I have a really funny example of that, and there is a famous problem called Cunningham's paradox. Has anyone heard of Cunningham's paradox? That's expected. It's actually from horse racing. When you breed horses, when you breed thoroughbreds, you want them to get faster. That's the goal. For the last 100 years, the result, if you expected faster horses, has been close to nil. Horses are not faster now than 30 years ago or 50 years ago. And yet people pay a lot for using stallions that were very fast runners. So how do we understand this? Well, there was one article that claimed that breeding has indeed been successful. The average horse is much, much faster. It's only on the very top level we don't see a development. You needed approximately 10 minutes, and now this was a very thorough paper in, I think, actually Nature, but I'm not sure. So maybe it's safe for me to forget what journal it was. But anyway, if you sat down and did a little computation, you would see that if the article was right, then the average horse would be much faster than the top horse. So the average horse would outcompete the winner of the Kentucky Derby, if we believe that article. So all the p-values, all the tables, everything was right, but no one had done this simple check, if it made sense. Now, so to really sit down and analyze the statement, to understand the theory, to understand the claim a continuous function is differentiable. I work a lot with that. How do I work with it? It's I usually have multiple choice questions, sometimes true and false questions. Sometimes they have to give a number. Part of the challenge is, of course, that my calculus students expect mathematics, at least in the beginning, they expect mathematics to be computations. So many of them work hard, you read a book, and then I ask about the text, what does this example tell us? Why is it there? And they know all kind of the details from about the example. And they will say, I think the example is there so we can understand how we can compute the limit. they don't know it is an illustration, it's a counterexample, that it has something to do with theory.
Thank you, Dr. Krona. Okay, we turn it over to Dr. Jacobs to talk about schools and society and going online.
Thank you. Let me begin by saying this is, I started working at AU in 1985, and this is probably the last public forum that I'll be participating in, because I am retiring this spring, and I want to say what I said to some of my colleagues. I loved being hired to work at AU in 1985. I've loved all the years I've done it, but I have to admit that I also love the prospect of not being in that space. So I'm going to talk about schools and society, which is one of the bedrock courses in the existing general education program. And seven of my colleagues teach or have taught the course. So it's something that is broadly integrated into the thinking about how we teach and what we teach. And because we have an external accrediting organization that looks at us, we have to have a kind of mission statement for the School of Education. And luckily, it parallels many of the goals that Jennifer described as being part of the general education. So what we try to do in all of our courses is we try to teach broad concepts to students who may not be familiar with the details. We encourage critical thinking and the ability to draw conclusions based on the available information. We greatly support and encourage robust discussion and debate, drawing from a broad spectrum of student opinions. And we try to create an environment where opinions can be expressed openly, candidly, even passionately, in an atmosphere of safety and mutual respect. So that's the starting point for our courses in our course called Schools and Society. And typically, those of us who teach the course try to build these objectives into the syllabus, the course readings, the assignments, and the class discussions. But as we all know, the world is not perfect, and neither is a course syllabus or a class section. So we're always challenged about constraints, and that's what I want to talk about this morning. In particular, I want to talk about two constraints that my colleagues and I have frequently faced in gen ed courses. First, how do you deal with the reality that strikes you that you're listening to a good discussion, even a very good discussion, and you don't want to cut it off, but if you allow it to continue, you won't be able to get through the other material that you had planned to cover. The constraint is time. Do you keep that lively, challenging, imaginative discussion going, even if it means you won't be able to discuss an article or a book chapter you ask students to read? I know I've been tempted to use a kind of summative and dismissive phrase like, let's move on. But if I do that, I run the risk of stifling the robust discussion and debate that we're really committed to. Fortunately, I think that my job today is to present issues and thankfully not to solve problems for you. So I'll simply suggest that a plausible answer to the what should I do in that situation is to strive for balance and let the importance of the topic and the energy of the students dictate when to let go of the schedule and sustain the discussion. Second, how do you deal with the intellectual integrity of a carefully crafted syllabus in which you work to create readings and assignments that represent a diversity?
One of those constraints that probably we gotta go.
So I was talking about the general category of the constraint that you need to deal with in terms of balance, and I wanted to give a very quick example from last semester. In schools and society, we teach three concepts that are fundamental to American schools: excellence, equity, and efficiency. As the discussion of equity got underway, I realized that many students were confused about the concepts of equity and equality. The discussion meandered, it was a little bit misleading, and I realized that I actually had an article somewhere that did a great job of differentiating between equity and equality. But if I change the reading for the next class, I might clarify equity and equality, but I would shortchange the discussion of efficiency. So I knew I couldn't do both, and the constraint was balance. And I needed to figure out how to deal with something that I knew was being misunderstood, along with my intellectual commitment to cover all the material that was part of the objectives of the course. As you can imagine, I had to make the decision while the class was ongoing and while I was listening and participating to the discussion. And even now, 2 months later, I'm not sure I ultimately made the right decision. So Jennifer asked me to sort of talk about that within the context of having also taught it this past semester as an online course. And the challenge I faced had to do with differences in structure between the two methodologies and the packaging of the course content. I've always viewed face-to-face courses as iterative and meandering and cascading, and I typically begin classes by saying, last time we met, and creating a context for where we were as a segue to where we were going. But in online courses, there's more of a temptation to see each class session as a defined box that you start and you finish, and once you finish, you move on to the next box. In my online course, the constraint I faced was that I thought too much about the boxes and didn't know how to craft a way to introduce segues and transitions as I've done face to face. Fortunately, by the end of the semester, I had figured out how to send an occasional email to everyone that had a bold-faced header, whoops, which gave me a chance to say, I should have mentioned this or that. Doing that made me feel more fallible and human, but guess what? The students already knew that. But it was a challenge to try and remember that I was teaching the same material, but the context was very different.
Thank you, Fred, and thank you to the panel. So I think we have time for a couple of questions. Folks, if you have a question, thoughts, want to weigh in with their own? Sure.
Yeah, so one of the things, what you were talking about, Fred, is something that I've struggled with, because I appreciate the need for having learning outcomes to both focus instructional design and bring together disparate instructors onto one common goal. There's also a tyranny of some of this that, and some of these things like the box, even the constraint of, you know, teaching online that's in there. And there are things that are difficult to measure but educationally critical, like a good discussion. And so in one way, you try to incorporate those into your learning outcomes. Karen Foster Jones would tell me that my evaluations of them suck, and they do, because they're hard to do. Jeff and I were just discussing in calculus, one of the things that connected with Christina is that there's an area, there's something in intro calculus called an epsilon delta group that's hard. Very few people understand it in the beginning. You can say, parrot it back to me, state it, but that's not a very good goal. What really we're talking about is understanding it the second time you see it. But that's not easily assessed. And similarly, when I developed courses, I wanted someone to gain appreciation of the beauty of mathematics. That's really hard to assess.
So how do you guys deal with the fact that you have things you really want? Like, there is something about a good discussion, there is something about these other things, but they don't assess, and then when you get stuck in learning outcomes, and I'll be honest, when, and this is way before Gen Ed now, when I developed a wild card, I found that trying to fit a square peg in a round hole was one of the worst educational experiences to design that that I had. So I kind of backed out and said I'm done with Gen Ed. So, yeah, how do you deal with that?
I just want to say, as a younger faculty member, I was always excited by the opportunity to teach new courses. And of course, over 30 years, I've ended up teaching some courses many, many times. But listening to Teresa, I was thinking there really is some value for doing it over and over again, because you pick up the subtleties so much faster because you been through it before. And I think we as individual faculty members have to strike a balance between, gee, I'd like to teach something new. That sounds like a good seminar to offer. And teaching something that you know so well that you don't have to wait until it's 45 degrees off. You know it when it's 2 degrees off.
Let me just say something, because a couple things came to mind. One, on the appreciate science, I have found with the paper activity that I do, you get that because you can use that really to measure that at some level, because I always ask the students to connect their topic to their major. And so they have to appreciate the science in order to make that connection. So I think that point. The other thing is, and we were talking outside, is I give my students a pretty detailed questionnaire on the first day of class, and I've discovered that they tell you everything on the first day of class, and they have become so important to me that I actually cart them with me back and forth every single day, because I learn about, you know, I have questions on that questionnaire about expectations. What are their expectations for themselves for this course? And I know what their major is, I know what their math background is, I ask them if they've done any kind of graphing, I mean, I ask all these detailed questions, I know what part of the world they're from, and that I build into the class every semester, which keeps it fresh for me. So I had some graphic design and kind of artsy people last spring, and so I was bringing in art gallery pictures and things like that, because I talk about color, but I expanded because I had that clientele. And so I think that, you know, to kind of pick up on what you're saying, teaching the same thing over, it's never the same because the clients are never the same. And Gen Ed is one of the reasons that I personally love teaching Gen Ed is those students ask the craziest yet most robust questions that have made me better understand physics because of the nature of the questions that I go home and scratch my head and email colleagues around the country and around the world. I've had a student that's asked this question and I don't know the answer to it. I guess that's enough out of me, but just sort of pick up on what you were saying.
So. I'm a bit curious on your questionnaire. I mean, I've tried something similar, not with that fantastic outcome that you see.
Well, yeah, I'm revising it again because I'm in the middle of writing an article on millennial learning in physics, and I'm co-authoring it with my millennial age son, which is kind of really exciting. And so I've been collecting data all last semester and this semester, so I'm gonna actually be massaging it to get some conceptual questions for this article. But, you know, dealing with everything from do you actually have access to a textbook for this course, which is a very relevant question, to screen time and everything in between, because I don't buy the whole argument that, you know, you'll hear people say students aren't as good as they used to be, or they're this or they're that. I'm concerned about a lot of things like electronic addiction. I think it's real, and I'm starting to see issues with that in my classes, and I've just gotten off topic, but I think that this is where Gen Ed comes in. Right, as we have redefined our core, or in the process of redefining our core, we have we have human beings and their life's experiences that they bring in. And so I think that for me, writing this article, and I'm finding that you can't just do a library search on millennials and learning, and that I'm not finding it. So I'm hoping that it will make a little tiny bit of a dent, and then I'll start doing something more, focus groups and things like that. So I'm interested in anything that anybody has to say about it.
I have a quick question, suggestion. During my gen ed course, I've noticed that progressively more and more students were using their laptop in class. And I end up to having half of the class that was having a laptop when we were in discussions or doing the lectures. And I tend to let students say we're taking notes, but I have read articles that suggest the idea of not allowing a laptop in class at all unless you have
What department are you in?
Chemistry. Okay. And so I'd like to take your ideas about having students. I mean, unless there is a physical need to use a laptop because you have a disability, would you allow students to have laptops during the class, or would you ask them not to have a laptop?
In the writing program, we actually have a wide spectrum of answers to that question. I have colleagues who routinely have the students constantly on laptops for all sorts of reasons. I'm on the opposite end. Unless we're using them all as a class, because sometimes we'll do work with research or they'll look at drafts or things. And I tell them that the way I pitch it on the first day is that I want them to, and this goes back to the idea of possibility space, right? That on the one hand, it's a constraint. You should not have your laptop open unless everyone has their laptop open for a reason. The affordance is you get a break from being wired. You get to be in a room with a bunch of faces rather than a bunch of screens. And I try to pitch it that way, that this is an opportunity you can't get when your face is down on the laptop. So that's just and it helps that our classes, I don't totally lecture, so there's not a lot of note-taking. So it's more like I said, group work and discussions and things. And so that's how I kind of manage it, is I tell them, it's an opportunity to commune with human beings in a confined space rather than that.
But you've still got this.
Oh, at the beginning of class, our routine after I take attendances, and I do it myself, put it in airplane mode, put it in a pocket, it does not come out again until class is over.
Yeah,
I call them out if they.
How big are your classes?
19.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's part of it. We have smaller classes. Yeah.
I would recommend that you get in touch with Ivy Broder, who is a professor in the economics department, and she teaches very, very large sections of, I think, microeconomics. But she was one of the first people on campus who said, no laptops in my course. And I think, going back a number of years, that she would say she posted a summary of the notes at the end of class so that there was no need for people to be doing that during class. But she was one of the first people who did that, and I believe her experience has been very successful.
And I know, just to piggyback, I know that I've read of and heard of some faculty who teach a lecture course with a lot of students, where they'll have a rotating schedule of students who are designated note takers in a Google Doc that the whole class has access to. And so like three people, depending on how large the class is, three people, it's your turn, you three, will take notes together so that there's three different ears listening, and then next week it'll be your turn, and this becomes a communal Google Doc that everyone has access to.
Let me thank the panel very much, and thank you guys for coming. Sorry about the fire alarm, and thank you all.